our candles each week, one for Wiley Dobbs, who lives in prison in Georgia, one for Kim and Stan, and all of our friends in Cuba, for all who have been impacted by COVID-19, for all who have been impacted by police brutality and violence, and for all of you gathered with us wherever you are.
This call to worship is from Psalm 51. Have mercy on us, O God, according to your steadfast love.
According to your steadfast mercy, forgive us.
Lead us in the paths of justice.
Guide us in the paths of peace.
You have placed your truth in the inner being.
Therefore, teach us the wisdom of the heart.
Forgive all that binds us in fear, that we may radiate love.
Cleanse us that your light might shine in us.
Fill us with gladness.
Help us to transform weakness into strength.
Create in us a clean heart, O God.
And put a new and right spirit within us.
Enfold us in the arms of love.
And fill us with your Holy Spirit.
Restore to us the joy of your saving grace.
And encourage us with a new spirit.
Well, it looks like it might be a hard road, but we're gonna walk it with you. And we know you might have a heavy load, but we can carry some too. We will lift you up when they push you down. We will raise our voice and stand our ground. Well, it looks like it might be a hard road, but we're gonna walk it with you. And it looks like it might be a long night, but we ain't going nowhere. And we know it's gonna be a hard fight, but we will stay right here. We will shine a light in the darkest hour. We will face the man in the tallest tower. Well, it looks like it might be a long night, but we ain't going nowhere. Well, it looks like it might be a perilous climb. We will follow your lead. And we know it might be a long time until the last one of us is freed. We will hold on tight, stay by your side. We will be with you through this rocky ride. Well, it looks like it might be a perilous climb. We will follow your lead. And it looks like it might be a hard road. We're gonna walk it with you. And we know you might have a heavy load, but we can carry some too. We will lift you up when they push you down. We will raise our voice and stand our ground. Well, it looks like it might be a hard road, but we're gonna walk it with you.
Welcome, friends. Welcome to this circle of mercy gathered for worship. We are grateful that you can join us from wherever you are. We so miss seeing you in person, but we have a few people who are representing all of you who are here in person. Our terrific band, Michael and Dale and Brian and Jennifer, plus we have Mark, Mahan, and Missy. And of course, we also have our little story time friends. Friends, this is a weekend in our country when we make our declaration. So let us declare our interdependence. Let us declare our imperfect union and our longing to live in a land of liberty and justice for all. Let us declare this a time of revolution of body and soul, transformed by Christ's Spirit. Let us declare God, our liberating and loving one who is still with us in the heart of the uncertainty and the upheaval of it all. And let us pledge our allegiance to our creating God together and declare our dependence on God and our dependence on a community united by a daring faith in God's vision for a world made whole. Guess what? If you could turn your heads, you could see that, why, our Circle of Mercy kids are here with us now. So make room. Come on in. There's plenty of room for our story time. And, oh, I really want to see you today. So I am glad. And I'm glad you are all here, too. You know, I have a question. I wonder, what does it look like if you carry around the Spirit of Jesus? You, monkey, you carry around a spirit of mischief. And you, puppy, well, you carry around a spirit of curiosity. And tiger, what about you? You carry around a spirit of fierceness. Oh yes, and there are times you do carry around a spirit of gentleness too. Yes. And what about you? What is your spirit that you carry around? Well, I want to tell you about a woman who had the Spirit of Jesus in her. Her name was Fannie Lou Hamer. And do you know, I have told this story so many times that the storybook is falling apart. But I think I know it pretty well now. I want you to know that Fannie Lou Hamer carried the Spirit of Jesus in her whole life long. She was born in Mississippi And she worked in the cotton fields just alongside all of her family. And it was very, very hard work. Why, even when she was just 6 years old, the white man who owned all of that cotton field would say to her, "Fannie Lou, you've got to pick up 30 pounds of cotton today." And at the end of the day, she would give her 30 pounds of cotton. And do you know, that man would hand her a can of sardines, a little bit of cheese, and a cookie. Fannie Lou grew up feeling hungry a lot of the time, and her whole family and the people in her community had a tough, tough time. And in that tough time, Fannie Lou's mother, she would sing to Fannie Lou. And it helped them all make it through those tough, tough days. And Fannie Lou learned how to sing. Why, she'd jump up on a table when she was just really little, and she'd start singing, "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine." And everybody would clap and sing along with her. And when she got older, she kept on singing. And when she was an adult, why, she was ready to vote. Why, she was old enough. And so she tried to register to vote. But back in that day, in 1962, when she tried to register to vote, why, there were laws that said, "You can't vote. No one who's an African American can vote in this country." Oh, Fannie Lou thought this was terrible. She kept trying, and with hundreds and even thousands of people, she would march and protest and say, "We have to have the right to vote. We need to vote. We're part of this country. We are citizens of this country, all of us." And she kept on singing, "This little light of mine." And she kept her light shining for Jesus' justice and mercy all through those days. When she protested and marched, she sometimes was even put in jail for trying to register to vote. And then one day, finally, she got the vote, and all the other people in her community did too. And they celebrated and they said, finally, the time has come. And Fannie Lou thought, well, we still need to do some more work. And she started the Freedom Farm so that people who didn't have land could come to the land and farm, and they could grow their own food. Why, there were lots and lots of people who were helped by Freedom Farm, all because of Fannie Lou Hamer, who had the spirit of Jesus in her. It was a spirit where everybody shared with each other, and everybody cared for each other, and everybody had enough to eat. And everybody shared the love and light that they had within them that brought them together. And Fannie Lou Hamer, she was at the center of it all. And she kept that spirit of Jesus alive. Thank you, Fannie Lou Hamer, for all you did and for letting the love of Jesus shine through you. You can let the Spirit of Jesus shine in you too. Let's see how the Spirit shines this week. We'll see you again next week and find out. The peace of Christ go with you all.
Circle of Mercy friends, our imaginations are challenged. I'm imagining you, wherever you are. We have a few here, but there are more of you out there. And you're having to imagine being a part of a larger community, Circle of Mercy. So let's activate the imagination and make it happen. We're one, we're together, and I have this chance to be with you for a few minutes. The Haywood Church for Homeless, when they would worship, I hope they'll be able to do that as a collective, but the way they end worship regularly is that Robert, one of the members of the community, for the benediction, would stand up and say to the congregation, "Who are you?" And they would say, "I'm a child of God." "Who are you?" "I'm a child of God." "Who are you?" "I'm a child of God." So that's the way I want us to begin our time together. I want us to set aside our wonderful mind, our thinking that loves to analyze and make sense of things. If we can, for 1 minute, just sort of set aside that wonderful thinking mind of ours that's always going, and sink down into your heart, and maybe put your hand over your heart and breathe in for just these moments. I am a child of God. I am forgiven. I am beloved. I am embraced with a love that will not let me go. However you want to word it, but let in that awareness, feel it. Just for these minutes, in your breathing, breathe in that awareness. Okay. Now let's get that thinking mind back, but put it in the heart. So we're thinking from the heart, awareness. And the only text today, is one text. You know it. It's one verse. It's so remarkable. It is kind of unbelievable prayer that we could never imagine happening. It's when Jesus was on the cross, dying, crucifying, being crucified, and he looks out and he says, "Abba, Abba, God, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." He said, they knew what they were doing. Pilate, the religious leaders, the soldiers, the crowd, even the disciples who Mark says were just fleeing out of fear, they knew what was happening. They were executing Jesus. They were killing Jesus. They were crucifying Jesus. They were murdering Jesus. That's what they were doing. It's obvious. But maybe they didn't know what they were doing. Maybe they didn't know that violence never solves problems. Maybe they didn't know that death for God is not the end. Maybe they didn't know what damage they were doing to their own heart that longs to connect and love. They had to stifle and stop that part of themselves. They wounded their soul in doing what they were doing. And those disciples, they were wounding their soul too, going against their allegiance to Jesus. In some ways they knew what they were doing. A few weeks ago, there was another crucifixion, another death, another murder, another killing of George Floyd. And that picture of his dying is etched in our minds. Like the fall of the Twin Towers on 9/11, I'm betting that for all of us, that picture, that death, that lynching, that crucifixion is in our minds. The picture of a white foot of power choking to death George Floyd's effort to breathe. And we know that that exploded an outpouring of rage by blacks, but also whites throughout the nation. We know that. We've felt it. That something in us realized, and it got named over and over again, that from the beginning of our time, beginning of our national time, the foot of white power has kept people of color from breathing fully into life. Stan Dotson, our friend in Cuba, in his blog, gave us a powerful metaphor. He said, racism is like particles of dust that are in the air all the time, and we just breathe them in and breathe it out without awareness. But occasionally a streak of light will come into the room, and you'll see all the dust particles that we've been breathing in and out. That's racism. And we're beginning to get that. We're beginning to hear and know, a little bit of knowing the real story of us going to another country and ripping the roots out of a person out of their roots of culture and family and religion, and bringing them on a ship to our land, half of them not living because of the inhuman conditions, coming to our land, being treated more like an animal than a person, as a slave. And then the results of that, that breathing of that oppression that takes place in laws like the story, the children's story. Fannie Mae Hammer, who fought for voting. So the air, the contagion got translated not just in outright slavery, but through laws and policies, keeping that foot on their full breathing capacity to live. We're beginning to know that. Now, all of you listening, because you're connected with the Circle of Mercy, you've been for racial justice all your life, certainly all your adult life. I'm counting on it. I know that. You have felt the injustice of racial inequity deeply. I have too. I'm old enough to have been a part of the last part of the civil rights movement. I heard Martin Luther King preach in our chapel seminary. All through the years, I've cared about racial justice. The two primary congregations I've served, we had partnership with African American congregation. And I thought I was doing good work. We were bringing about racial equity. I assumed a partnership. That really wasn't possible without dealing with all the dust, all that history we're all breathing. And I got a clue every few times. David, the pastor of one of those churches, we were talking on July the 4th, and we were talking, I guess, about what we're going to do, or maybe just enjoying each other. We were friends. And I said at the end, I said, David, it's holiday, what you going to do? David said, this is not my holiday. Oh, I didn't know that, really. And then later, another friend who was in his 70s, mature leader, and he told me, and I was in a group, and he said, I wake up every morning figuring out how I'm going to navigate a white world. And he said, I'm always worried about my two boys. I don't wake up in the morning wondering how I'm going to navigate the world as a white male. So it, for me, and maybe for you, I thought I knew a lot more than I do. And my not knowing is really showing up about the real face of racism. But the veil is getting pulled back more and more. So I have good news for you and for me. We're living out of a story that gives us some good news here. Jesus prayed, Father, God, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Father, forgive them. They are beginning to know what they're doing, but not much. Walter Wink, the New Testament scholar, said that John the Baptist came preaching, repent and be baptized. I mean, repent and be forgiven. That makes sense. If we can work enough with dismantling that racism within us and in our system and move more and more toward justice, then maybe we can be forgiven. But Wink goes on to say, Jesus came preaching, be forgiven, then repent. Wow. That thing we were feeling about our identity is I'm forgiven, I'm loved with a love that will not let me go, that I'm grounded in this amazing grace of being fully loved, that comes first. You ground yourself in that. Is that what you're saying? Nancy, last week, in her sermon, talked about the text of the friends who labored, who let down their friend in breaking open the roof, letting him down in front of Jesus, the one, his friend that needed healing. Did you get the first thing that Jesus said? Be forgiven. Then he healed. Maybe really living into the marvelous grace of being forgiven comes first. Then we can do the hard work of healing. That's good news. Not long ago, I hurt a friend. I said something in jest with a group that hurt him. He overheard it. And he came to me a few days after that. And he said, "Mahan, I know what you said was said in jest, but it lodged in me and I carried the hurt till now. And I needed you to know what happened." I was chagrined, I was upset, and I just had to say, "I'm sorry, would you forgive me?" And we talked about it, we talked about our relationship, and the relationship deepened. But it was all possible only because he could count on me loving him. Regardless. And that could count on him loving me enough to speak truth to what I needed to hear. And that's what we're talking about here, is that through the grace of God, we are held with a love that doesn't demand perfection. It takes us as we are. We're forgiven. So that we can do the painful, joyful work of dismantling the racism within us and within our society. It gives us the security, a place from which to risk the hard work of justice. But if it's just me and my personality, I'll be too defensive. If that's my identity, just me, it won't work. I won't risk. I won't be open. But if I am rooted and grounded in a love that won't let me go, perhaps I could be open for the truth I need to hear and to know. Friends, if you know that truth, it will make you free. If you live into that truth of who you really are, beloved, loved, forgiven, graced, if you can ground yourself in that love, that frees us to do the hard work of risking being further transformed into Christness. It helps us to take a little more risk, more steps in being open to the truth of our racism and other isms, and be a part of what God intends for us all to be transformed personally and socially into the beloved community. Hear it as good news out of our story. Father, Abba, God, forgive them, for they don't really know what they're doing. Or as they begin to know what they've been a part of, forgive them. To know that truth, take it in, it'll make us free. To know that truth, that we begin with forgiveness, that will make us free to be about of the transformation of racism. That repentance, that hard work of changing, the joy of it and the pain of it. We'll be free to enter into that transformation that God intends for us personally and for us as a people. It is good news. Know that truth. Know that truth, and it will set you free. It will set us free. So let that be. So let it be. Amen.
In prayers and in songs, pronouns are important. Even if one's praying the traditional Lord's Prayer by oneself, you wouldn't say, "My Father," it's always, "Our Father." The spiritual, "I Will Overcome," was transformed into the civil rights anthem, "We Shall Overcome," and the spiritual, "I Will Not Be Moved," became, "We Shall Not Be Moved." And in the song we did tonight, "Looks like it's going to be a hard road, but I'm going to walk it with you," became, "We're going to walk it with you." Now, because in Alcoholics Anonymous and other 12-step programs, while in folks meeting groups, there's also the individual struggle. So what's a prayer that's identified a lot with Alcoholics Anonymous, known as the Serenity Prayer, begins, "God grant me this serenity," so forth. But the song was written, the prayer was written a long time ago. It was written in 1943. The United States was still clawing its way out of the Great Depression, and we were 4 years into a world war, and at that point, there was no way to know whether the Axis or the Allies were going to win. So it was a matter of we had to work together. And if you've looked closely at the logo for the Circle of Mercy, it's a circle of people all holding hands. So even though we're doing this, you know, through video, we're holding hands. And while we can pray alone, we come together for this time of prayer. And among the folks we want to remember at this time of prayer are our leaders and law enforcement officers across our nation, our state, our county, and in our city. Jen and Andy and others who are traveling. We want to give thanks that Beth and Don arrived safely in Nashville, thanks to Mercy Movers. We hold in prayer all those who are struggling with COVID-19 and their caregivers and the medical folks who are on the front line. And for our friend Lewis, who is recuperating, he's back at Bella Vista. And for your own requests, let's as a circle hold those. And we'll close with the prayer that Reinhold Niebuhr wrote in 1943. God, give us grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things that should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Amen.
We continue to be troubled. We continue to participate and be caught within systems that exclude, damage, and destroy the lives of the most vulnerable in our communities and throughout all of creation. We long for a different reality that we know is possible, but that has not been realized yet. God continues to trouble us, but also reminds us through this meal that we do not do this work on our own. When the disciples walked with Jesus, he taught them about a way that was different. His way of walking through the world and the way he treated people challenged the status quo and the cultural norms that existed. The way of life that he called the disciples to and that he calls us to would turn the world upside down. And for those who found themselves close to him, they knew that they wanted to live in that upside down world because it offered freedom and hope for all. And it was grounded in an all-consuming love that would not let them go. We too yearn to live in that upside down world. We too want to keep walking in the way with Jesus. So we return to this table each week and remember that on the night when Jesus gathered with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Every time you eat this meal, remember me." In the same way, he took the cup and gave thanks, said, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you and for many. Every time you drink from this cup, remember me." So friends, come to this table and share in this meal that has been prepared for each of you, where we are reminded that death is not the final word.
Put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. You gotta put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Don't give up hope. You're not alone. Don't you give up. Keep moving on. You gotta put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. You gotta put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Lift up your eyes, don't you despair. Look up ahead, the path is there. We gotta put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. We gotta put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. Put one foot in front of the other and lead with love. And lead.
Circle friends, as we go into the next part of our living, having been together in this mysterious, marvelous gift of community. Remember who you are. As you go, remember who you are. You're a child of God. You are loved with a love that will not let you go. And you are fully forgiven, thereby freeing you to be about the work of repentance, change, transformation. Your transformation and the transformation of our society. Go remembering who you really are.